Hi guys, good morning. Two of you are there.
Morning, sir.
Good morning. So guys, how's it going in school? Have they started pressurizing you for board exams? School reopened?
Yeah. I heard for me, 10th and 12th, no?
I heard that for 10th and 12th class, I think they will start the schools, right? How's it going? After a long time, you're ending up with school. Like, how is it? Like, everybody can present the same class or only 50% attendance?
No, sir. Like, everyone, but they divide into two classes.
Okay. Understood. So,
entirely we have pre-boards, then we have practicals.
Okay. So, in your batch of 12th, in your school, how many students are there?
27.
So they are divided into two sections. This will be in computer science and science.
While writing exams, they just divide you into two classes and then invigilator and exam.
No. What I'm asking is now you start going to school, right? So like, how is it happening? You're like per day, only one batch will go, other batch will go. Is it like
it's
that?
It's exams only. So they,
now it's exams only. Okay. Understood. So I think now from now on, you'll have only exams. I think schools would have completed your portions also, isn't it? Yeah. 7, 6 and still only two of you. So how was it meeting your friends after a long time? Were there any strict protocols that you need to maintain social distance and stuff? You should not talk and stuff over there.
Yes, oh my god.
Yeah. That comes along with this.
But it was consensual, so half of them didn't come.
Only if your parents' consent is there, you can come. Correct. Yes.
We had one day of school this week, but from next week it properly starts.
Okay. Nice. At least something is starting. Like, we cannot complain, right? I have to go to college. Basically, this was my first semester. Like, when I started my college, it was August. So entire August till this first semester over, I wrote my semester exams also. I got my results and still no college. I mean, college is happening. The second semester is starting. I have chosen my courses. So I think this semester also will go online only, most probably. Maybe next month or the March, maybe I'll go to college. Till then, it is going to be online classes. Colleges will have that too. Mine is a government institution, like Indian Institute of Science Education and Research. So the government institutions and generally any college will have good infrastructure, like when it comes to conducting exams online or say conducting classes online. So, but the small schools, the bigger schools will eventually survive. But the small schools, the medium level schools, those are the ones actually will suffer so much. Right?
So you go to IIT or Bhopal, sir?
No, Tirupati. There are 7 places, Pune, Kolkata, Bhopal, Tirupati, Trivandrum, where else? Belrampur, there is Odisha, and one more place is there.
There's no quality difference at all, no, sir, between those cities.
It would be different, but the thing is, say, Isar Tirupati and Isar Belrampur is the latest one. I think 2016 or 17 only, Isar Belrampur has started. And Isar Tirupati started in 2012, if I'm not wrong, right? But yeah, quality difference, you will not find quality. You will find quality difference in the labs because ISER Pune was established, I think, 20 years back. ISER Pune is the first one.
Yes.
So again, ISER Trivandrum will be good. ISER Kolkata, after ISER Pune, ISER Kolkata is the best. So it all depends on when it came. More and more time it has been, more and more infrastructure. It's all about the research output they produce. So accordingly, the government will allocate funds for them. So since these are relatively new, all facilities will be there. You cannot complain. Faculties will be amazing. All postdocs, all foreign things, everything will be there. But definitely there will be differences between ISER Pune and if you compare ISER Tirupati. Yes, there will be definitely differences.
Sir,
Oh, there's ISO Bangalore also, no?
That is IISc. That is the top class. That is Indian Institute of Science. That also I tried, but so there's this exam called as JAM exam, Joint Admission Test. So only if you clear that, you'll be able to join these colleges. So if you want to go into IISc, you need to be at least in top 50. And my rank was around 300, 400. So yeah, I was eligible for all the IITs, but again, there will be a problems. IITs, what's the problem is, if you want to do MSc, you should have done BSc, or at least you should have taken BTech chemical engineering, something like that. But I didn't do any of that. I did BTech in electronics and instrumentation, and just because of my interest, I wrote, and then yes, I cleared it. So like a lot of colleges I applied, a lot of colleges. At last, I said I almost lost hope that I'm not going to get this time. At last, I got a mail from, I got IIT Palakkad also. I got IIT Palakkad and I got ISAT Tirupati, and I chose ISAT Tirupati. So why I chose ISAT Tirupati is, if you take IIT, any IIT, not only any IIT for that matter. So you'll finish your MSc, and if you want to do PhD after that, again have to write an exam. It's called CSIRNET. It's one of the toughest exam all over the world, not only in India. So that exam you have to clear, and then only you will be awarded. You can apply for PhD, how you apply for JEE mark in for BTech, like that. You have to apply with this mark for PhD. So, but if you take the mark, what I'm doing here in ISAT Tirupati is integrated PhD. So it's MSc plus PhD in 6 years. So I don't have to write any exam. I just after I complete my MSc, I'll directly go for PhD. So that's what I thought. And one more thing is, IITs are famous for technical education. Say they are very famous for engineering, M.Tech, B.Tech. That's why it's called technology, IIT, Indian Institute of Technology. What I'm doing is pure science. So it is better to do in a pure science institute like IISc or IISCR, or I have NICER also, and National Institute of Science Education and Research. It's in Bhubaneswar. So these are the places which you can opt for. Right. And you can also opt, guys. Like, please don't have only JEE as your this thing. You can write BITSAT. And for ISER, if you're interested in pure science, all ISERs, all the seven ISERs are giving BS, MS integrated programs. That is, in 4 years, you'll be completing BSc as well as MSc. That's the integrated program they have. It's amazing course. You will
That's a
love
dual
to, if
degree.
you, it, yeah, it's a dual degree. There is no MSc alone in any of the government institutes as such. If you want to go to pure science area, you will have only one option to go to ISIS or IISc. Again, IISc also only has integrated programs, BSMS it's called. So it's an amazing program. I see students, right? See, I have taught chemistry for 6 years, and I know some chemistry. Like these guys who compete with me, from BSMS. Amazing, so competitive, so competitive. Yeah. And they'll be a little more younger than me also. And eventually my batch people itself are younger than me. Obviously, they'll be at least 2, 3 years younger than me. Because they would have just completed BSc and they would have applied for MSc PhD. Now I finished my BTech, that is 4 years. And then I worked for 3 years in BYJUS. And then I did this. So yeah, pretty late, but still. Now it's never too late. Right. And you can also have this option. You can not apply through JEE mains for these institutes. There is a separate test for all the ISERs. It's called ISER Aptitude Test. Right. So that if you clear, again, counseling will happen. Counseling will happen, which like you have to choose which, you have to give your priorities. And if your marks are good, that particular institute will take you. So it's like that. But it's really worth it, man. It's really worth it. Like, if you're really interested in pure science, and not only chemistry, physics, chemistry, math, biology, four departments will be there. So any of that you can take. Right. So yeah, it's almost 7:15. I think almost all of you are there. Right. Enough of stories. I'll share my screen. So guys, we have completed organic. I mean, not completed, but we have touched almost all the important reactions in organic. There are only few left that we'll see later. So I have also completed thermodynamics, if you remember, right? So the next chapter will be a physical chapter, and we are going to take equilibrium today. So EQLM is the short form, right? So equilibrium. You must have already known equilibrium so much. You must have studied. So I will just quickly go through whatever the concepts we need. Okay, right. Fine. So we know what do you mean by equilibrium in general, isn't it? So equilibrium means the state where nothing changes, right? If I say that I'm in equilibrium, that means that I'm just sitting and doing nothing. It's something that way. Right. So if at all you can, if at all you want to visualize in any physical sense, say I have a particle, right? Say this side, I applied a force of F, right? This side, I apply a force of F, same. This F and this F are same. So obviously this particle would be at equilibrium, right? So whenever all the forces acting on a particle is going to be equal and opposite, right? So again, I say that particle will be in equilibrium, right? Say in terms of chemical reaction, I have to speak. Right. Say now I can draw a graph and show you how is it gonna be. Right. Say if I draw a graph between concentration and time. Right. So there'll be two graphs, isn't it? Say if I have the normal reaction R giving P, that is reactants giving products is the reaction. Right. So initially, obviously, you will have some amount of reactants present. Right. Say I assume that there are no products formed initially at time t is equal to zero. Right. So at time t is equal to zero, you will have some concentration of reactant R. Right. Now, as the reaction proceeds, you know that the reaction of the amount of reactants keeps on decreasing because they are getting consumed in the reaction. Right. So you will see that the graph will be something like this. Actually, it is joining there. Okay. Right. So the graph will be something like this. It will keep on decreasing. Right. Now, at time t is equal to zero, the product might not be there, right? Say I have zero concentration of products initially, right? And the product concentration keeps on increasing, right? So it'll keep on increasing. So you will find the graph to be something like this. Okay. Now, I would say till this region, right? You see that the values are changing. That is the reactant concentration and the product concentrations are changing. Right. But after this point, maybe it's not really proper if I can draw it a little more. Okay. So you see that the curves are attaining saturation, isn't it? Say this point and this point, if you check after that, the concentrations of reactants and the concentration of products are not changing. Right. So at this point, I will call that the reaction. I will say that the reaction has reached equilibrium, right? Concentrations of the reacting species. Reacting species in the sense, whichever is in the reaction medium, which is both reactants and products, right? So at whichever point of time you see that the concentrations of them are not changing, that I say is equilibrium, right? Okay. Now there are going to be two types of chemical reactions, right? I can have irreversible chemical reactions, reversible chemical reactions, right? We spoke so much about it in equilibrium, if you can remember. Right. So generally, if it's a irreversible process, right, we say that it is very fast, right, spontaneous, right. And if it's a reversible process, we know it's infinitesimally slow. I mean, ideal reversible process will actually never come to an end. But in general, reversible process is very, very slow. Right. And if we take an example, right, say, I can give an example like this. Say, for example, I have sodium. Is it happening? Okay, so I have sodium. If I dissolve it in water, right, I think this is one of the very first reactions you would have seen in your chemistry labs in 9th class, I would say, so, or at least 10th class, you should have seen. You would have cut a very small portion of sodium, right, and would have put it in a bath of water, right. You will see that the reaction is actually violent, is it not, right? So this reaction is so fast that it will easily form NaOH. It will gonna form NaOH and hydrogen gas will be evolved, isn't it? And this reaction is very, 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 very fast, right? And what happens, say, for example, if I leave water, water will not take. Say, assume that I started with some 1 gram of sodium, okay? Right now, the reaction is going to be so fast, and without in a blink of an eye, you will see that at some point of time, this will become zero. That is the concentration of reactant, that is sodium, would have become zero, right? And obviously, some amount of products will be there. That is no doubt, right? So what I'm trying to say is, if it is an irreversible process, that is, if it is a spontaneous process, which is very, very, very fast, right? They generally tend to go for 100% completion. Right? They tend to go for 100% completion. Say if I have NaOH reacting with HCl, a strong acid, strong base reaction, right? So again, you will see at the end of the reaction, the NaOH concentration and HCl concentration will be almost zero. And not, I mean, ideally speaking, zero. But in reality, you will see that is almost 97 or 98% completion. Again, all the other factors depend, the temperatures and stuff, but still normal room temperature. Ideally speaking, 100% completion if I'm going to have for irreversible processes. Okay, so that is the reason why if I want to do any kind of calculations, right? If I want to do any types of calculations in these kind of reactions, whenever I have an irreversible process and I want to do some calculation, right? Now the calculations are really not going to be coming, the calculation will not come out to be good. Why? Because you are seeing that there is going to be a zero, which is going to come at some point of time. Right. So at least I would say this is the part where I have equilibrium reached, is it not? We will see that this concentration is not going to change as soon as this happens. That is when the reactant concentration became zero. Right. So if at all you want to do any calculation in this part at the equilibrium stage, right, you are really not going to get any useful numbers. Why? Because something is becoming zero. Right. So that is the reason why we do not concentrate on irreversible reactions in equilibrium. We concentrate only on our favorite part, that is your reversible reactions. Right. Okay. Now, why you can understand, right? Because in case of a reversible reaction, you will never see this happening. That is the concentration of any one of them becoming zero. You are never, ever going to see it. Right. Now, let me tell you how. Let me take a case. Right. Let me take a normal case and we'll see what happens. Right. So now assume that I have a irreversible reaction. Say, let me write it as R giving T, and you know how you have to represent it, right? So you have to put a double arrow. That means that forward reaction is possible, backward reaction is possible. Right. Okay. So assume that I started with 1 mole of the reactant, right? And initially at time, this is that time T is equal to zero. Right. So initially 1 mole of reactant is there, no product is formed. Right. Say as the time goes by, right. Say next step, I say that some X moles of reactant would have reacted. This is the remaining number of moles. 1 minus X is remaining. So X moles has reacted. Now you can see from the stoichiometry, the stoichiometric ratio is 1:1. That means if 1 mole of this reacts, 1 mole of product is formed. That means if X moles reacts, I will be getting X moles of products. Right. Say now another, some more will react, 1 minus. Assume that some Y moles react. Right. So 1 minus X was already remaining. Some more is reacting. Say it now, it will become X plus Y. Right. It will become X plus Y. Already X is there. Now, so Y is reacting, that Y will come here. Right. So this will keep on happening. Right. So at a point of time, what is happening is, I assume that after some time, you will see that, say, assume that I have some A moles left. Okay. I have some. Why is it happening? Okay, I have some A moles of reactant left, and say assume that I have some B moles of products left. Okay, after at a point of time, right? So now what will happen is, say assume that some M moles Okay, some M moles of reactant is forming, that M moles will come here. Right, now again, what can happen is, now see, this product can also form reactants, isn't it? So whatever came from the reactant, that is this M moles, again will react to give back here. Again, same M moles will react and give back here. So what you're seeing, right, what you're seeing here is that this is the part where I have reached equilibrium. I hope you understand how, right? So even though you see that something is changing, this M is going here and coming back, M is going here and coming back, all this is happening, but this overall concentration A and B, right, is actually not going to change, right? So this kind of equilibrium is what is called as dynamic equilibrium, because you see that something is happening, right? But overall, the change is not happening. The overall change is zero, right? The A and B are going to be constant, right? So this M might be a small, very small amount, which reacts and goes to the product side. Again, it reacts, goes, come back to the reactant side, right? So this kind of equilibrium is what is called as dynamic equilibrium. Now you see that this will never become zero. This A and B can never, ever, ever be zero. Right, so that is the reason why we do calculations based on equilibrium only in case of reversible processes and not irreversible processes. Right? Okay. So hope you understand how equilibrium works in case of a reversible reaction. Right, and that is going to be a very important thing—a dynamic equilibrium. Right. Okay. Now, since you know chemical kinetics, right? Since you have already studied chemical kinetics, now this particular thing, whatever I told you, right? Can be expressed in this way. Can you tell me what is that? In terms of kinetics, how will you define equilibrium? Is that what I'm asking? In terms of rate of the reaction, how will you define equilibrium?
Rate of reaction, the reactant is equal to rate of
Okay, product. I understand what you're telling. So the proper way of putting it is the rate of the forward reaction is equal to the rate at which the backward reaction is happening. That means the rate at which reactants give products is equal to the rate at which products gives back reactants, right? So this is the condition, or I would say this is the way in which I define equilibrium for a reversible process. Right. So initially, this will not be same. So you can see from this itself, you can see that first of all, products are not even forming reactants at a certain until a certain point of time. Right. But after equilibrium is reached, right, you see that this is happening. Right. So at this point of time, I say that the rate of the forward reaction is equal to the rate of the backward reaction. Correct. Right. Fine. So we already know so much about these rates. Right, we will do problems on that, don't worry. Like once we finish the 11th class chapters, we'll do problems on all the 12th class chapters and extra things, whatever is there, I'll teach you. Right, so this is the condition for equilibrium for reversal process. The rate of the forward reaction is equal to the rate of the backward reaction. Correct, right? So now the calculation, all these things I'm saying, right? So there is a factor, right? There is a constant which is going to help us find out or I do any sort of calculations in this reversible processes or reversible chemical reactions. And that is what is called as my equilibrium constant. Correct, right? So equilibrium constant is what generally you represented capital K, right? And you know, you have something, rate constants also for RF and RB that you represented with small k generally, right? So equilibrium constants are represented by capital K. Okay, so anyways, we know what is the definition for this. You should have done this in your chemical kinetics chapter, right? So we know that it is nothing but it is the ratio of the forward rate constant, right? It is the ratio of forward rate constant and the backward rate constant, isn't it? So now hope you remember this one. Law of mass action, right? So from this only you would have derived something called as a rate law equation. Or this is also called as rate law actually. right? It's also called as rate law, right? So like you should have seen this, but again, we'll take down the definition, guys, for this first. Take down the definition. The rate of a chemical reaction, the rate of a chemical reaction is directly proportional to, the rate of a chemical reaction is directly proportional to the product of, directly proportional to the product of active masses of, product of active masses of reactants, product of active masses of reactants raised to the powers of their stoichiometric coefficients, raised to the powers of their stoichiometric coefficients. Right, so I repeat the statement, right? So it is, I mean, the law of mass action states that the rate of a chemical reaction is directly proportional to the product of active masses of reactants raised to the power of the stoichiometric coefficients, right? So basically from this, what I can say is, what it says, again, if I put it in the form of an equation or a mathematical equation, so R will, the rate of reaction, any reaction for that matter, say if I have, first, I'll specify the reaction. So if I have a reaction like AA plus BB, gives CC plus DD, if I have a reaction like this, so what it says is that obviously now if it's a reversible reaction, right? So you have to tell two different rates. One is the rate of the forward reaction, and the rate of the forward reaction, A and B are the reactants. Right. If I take RB, that is backward reaction, you will see that C and D are the reactants, right? Okay. So anyways, so what it says is that this RF or this RB is directly proportional to the active masses. Okay. Now, what is this term active mass? Right. So active mass is nothing but the actual amount of the reacting species taking part in the reaction, as simple as that, right? So generally what happens is if I have some 10 grams, of reactants, right? So generally only 8 grams of it will be capable of undergoing the reaction. Rest 2 grams, whatever you do, will not react, right? So that 8 grams out of the 10 grams is what is called as active mass, right? So generally they use something called as activity coefficients to find out all that. But in now for our levels, that is for your school level, we really don't have to worry about anything. Whatever is there, that entire concentration you take. I mean, active mass generally means concentration. Like this active mass can be of two types. Right. It can be general. Okay, so let me write it here. Active mass. Right. Can generally be molarity values. Okay, bear with it, guys. Okay. Molarity values, or it can be partial pressures. Right, it can be partial pressures, or very rarely they can be mole fractions also. X, right? There can be more, but again, 90% of 99% of times, only these two will use. And depending on what kind of reaction I have, right? If the reaction is full of gases, all these A, B, C, D, whatever you see are gases, then there is no point in talking about concentration. You have to talk about pressures only, right? But if at all they are aqueous solutions, right? And in that case, I'll be talking about molarity. Right. So anyways, active mass is nothing but the concentrations or the partial pressures. That's what you need to know. Right. And one more thing also you need to know about active mass is that if in a reaction, right, you see that there are pure liquids or pure solids, right, their active mass value is one. Please make a note of it. What I'm trying to tell you is for solids, right, for solids, and liquids, that is pure solids and pure liquids, right, the active mass is always one unity, right? That means, let me tell you how it works. Say for now, we'll concentrate on this rate law. So what it says is that the RF, that is the rate of the forward reaction, or any rate for that matter, is directly proportional to the concentration or the product of concentration of reactants A, B, right? Now, it's not only that the product of active masses, that is the product of concentrations, right? And obviously, it has to be raised to the power of the stoichiometric coefficients, that is A and B here, right? So now I can put a constant removing this proportionality sign. Right. So now how it will be? It will be RF is equal to KF into A power A into B power B. Right. Say now this RB, same way I can write thus that the reactants will change, rate constant will change. Now KF and KB are what are called as rate constants. Right. So that will be C power C into D power D. All these things you will have. Right. So now this is where this, now what happens at equilibrium? At equilibrium, I have to choose this, right? At equilibrium, I say that the RF is equal to RB, right? Then you take the ratio of this, that is when you take the ratio of KF and KB. So what will you end up is this K, or in this case, it's going to be KC in terms of concentration, right? Will be C power C, product concentration first in the numerator, D power D divided by A power A and B power B, right? But you have to be very, very, very careful in these equations. Now, please understand the concentrations value you are taking here, A, B, C, D's concentration are equilibrium concentrations. That is when the reaction has reached equilibrium, because you have taken this particular term only at equilibrium. Is it not? RF is equal to RB. You can make this, all these things you can do only at equilibrium, right? So same way, the concentrations you will take, all A, B, C, D's concentration you will take, the concentrations are going to be there at equilibrium. These are equilibrium concentrations, not the initial concentrations, not what you initially start with, right? So these are equilibrium concentrations. So same way, I have KC, I can even have KP, right? KP is in terms of pressure. Now what will happen? Instead of concentration, you put partial pressures. That's it. That's the only difference. So it will be PC power C, PD power D, PA power A and PB power B. That's it. That's what would have been there. Again, those are equilibrium partial pressures, not the initial partial pressures. Right? Okay. Cool. So we'll move on. Any questions, guys? Any questions till now? This one all you must have already known. That's why I'm going very little quick. Any questions?
No.
Okay. Fine. We'll move on. Right. So now we'll see what are the properties of this equilibrium constant. We understood what is an equilibrium constant, how to frame it, how to calculate it, all these things we saw. Now we'll see what are the properties of K, equilibrium constant. Right. First one, right, it is independent of the initial concentration. It doesn't matter. Okay, it is independent of initial concentration or the partial pressure, right? Basically, the value of K is not going to depend on whatever you start with, how much you start with, or how less you start with. It is really not going to matter, because you can see it's going to be a ratio between the reactant concentration and product concentration. How much ever you start with, or how much ever less you start with, eventually the ratio at the end, at the equilibrium when is reached, is going to have a constant value. Okay, so this is a very important thing. So some people just think that this is another statement, but this is actually one of the important statements regarding K, right? It is really not going to depend on the initial concentration. So how much you start with doesn't matter. Second, it is temperature dependent, right? That means the value of K will be, say, at 25 degrees Celsius, you will have one value. And at say 50 degrees Celsius, you have another value of K. Same amount of reactant, everything is same, but the K value will change, right? It is going to be temperature dependent, right? Maybe I don't think you have it in the syllabus, but there is actually equation connecting temperature and the equilibrium constant. But anyways, we don't have to go into details of that. But you can see, you have seen Arrhenius equation, isn't it? You know how rate constant will change with respect to temperature. You hope you remember the equation. It was K. Can anyone tell me what is the equation? Arrhenius equation. K is equal to, this is not equilibrium constant, this is a rate constant. What is it? K is equal to Arrhenius equation. Chemical kinetics, Arrhenius equation, what is it? How is it possible? Thank you so much. Yes, A e power.
Activation energy by RT.
Okay, A power minus EA by RT. Okay, this was the equation. So you can see there is a relationship between rate constant and T. So it can be interpolated to equilibrium constant also. So that's what I'm trying to say. Right. So anyways, we don't have to concentrate on this now. Okay. So second point being, it is temperature dependent. That's what I need to know. Right. Third one, if you check, right. Say, I have a reaction like R giving B. Is a reaction to me, right? Now, if I say this is K1, the equilibrium constant, assuming, or okay, equilibrium constant is K1, right? Now, if I reverse this reaction, if I write P giving R, right? Now, say this is some K dash, right? Now, what is the relationship between this and this is the question, right? For the forward reaction, you have the equilibrium constant as K1. For the backward reaction, how it will be? It is very simple, right? How will you write K1? K1 will be equal to product concentration divided by reactant concentration, right? Now, how will you write this? This you will write it as reactants R divided by P, right? Now, what do you see? This K and K dash are actually going to be reciprocals. Okay, so what I'm trying to tell you is that if you know the equilibrium constant of the forward reaction, the K dash will always be 1 by K, this K or K1, whatever you call it. So this K1 is what is the equilibrium constant of the forward reaction. And this K dash is the equilibrium constant of the backward reaction. This will hold good for any reaction for that matter. Okay, the forward forward equilibrium constant and the backward equilibrium constant are reciprocals of each other. That's what you need to know. That's the third position. That's the third point. Okay, moving on. Fourth. Right, now fourth point is, say, now I have this reaction like A giving or R giving P or whatever it is. Right, R giving P is the reaction. Right, now what I do is I multiply by a factor of n. Right, say I multiply through. Okay, so assume that for this it is K, the equilibrium constant is K, and if I multiply this reaction by a factor of n, it will become n R giving n P. This is a factor. This number can be 2 or 3 or 4 or even whatever the number you want. Right, now again, say this for this reaction, it will be K dash. Right, now the question is, what is the relation between these two? Right, now it will be very simple. If you just write the equilibrium constant in terms of R and P, again it will be P divided by R for the first reaction. Now if you do this, K dash will be P power n. You have to raise it to the stoichiometric coefficient. Hope you remember that, right? So it will be P power n divided by R power n. Right, R power n. Or I can even write this particular term as something like this. The whole thing power n, right? And this whole thing, this one, is what is here, and that was my previous equilibrium constant. So you can see that K dash, that is when you multiply by a factor of n, the equilibrium constant will be the previous equilibrium constants raised to that power n, whatever the number you multiply, right? That number has to be raised to the previous equilibrium constant. Okay, so this is another property. So first one was reversing the reaction. Second one is multiplying throughout by a factor. Right, and in last one it will become the reciprocal. Now in this case, the old equilibrium constant power whatever the factor you multiply, that will be the new equilibrium constant. Right, okay, last property, fifth one. Right, so here say I have reactions like A giving B is one reaction. Say for this it is K1. Okay, say now say I have another reaction B giving C. Say for this it is K2, assuming, right? And okay, this is K2, right? Now I want the reaction for, I want the reaction this, that is I want the reaction of A giving C, right? Now what do? You definitely are going to add these two reactions, right? So when you add these two reactions, what will you see? B and B will get cancelled, right? So all you have is A giving C, right? Now I have to find what is the new equilibrium constant. Say I call it K. Right? If I call it K, so what is the relationship between K, K1 and K2 is the question, right? Now, if you do it properly, now K1, how will you write? It will be B divided by A, right? And this will be C divided by B. And here, if you check, it is actually going to be C divided by A, right? So now if you understand the relationship, if I multiply these two, what will happen? Again, B and B will get cancelled. What will be remaining? C divided by A is what is remaining. Okay, so that is what you need to understand. So when you add two reactions, right? And if you're going to get the third reaction, right? The equilibrium constant of the new reaction is equal to the product of the added reactions. That is K1 into okay, K1 into K2. That's what is going to happen. Now, same way, if you subtract a reaction, that will become division. K1 by K2 it will become. Okay, so these are the things you have to remember. First one was reversal. It will become reciprocal. Second one was multiplying throughout by a factor of N. It will become the old constant power N. And when you add or subtract two reactions, the equilibrium constants has to be multiplied or divided respectively. That's it. These are all the different what is that? Properties of the equilibrium constant. Okay, definitely problems will come from this. I mean, definitely there is a huge possibility that the problems can come from this. Okay, right, from this area. Right, cool, moving on. Right, is there any, you can always stop me and ask people, right? I'm just going little fast because you already know these topics, right? Okay, done. So now we understood what are the properties of equilibrium constants. Now there is a connection, guys. There is a connection between Kp and Kc. Okay. So you know there are the two equilibrium constants, one with respect to concentration, the other with respect to pressures, partial pressures, right? So I'm going to give you the formula directly. There is a derivation for this. If you're interested, you can go through your NCERT textbooks. It will be given there. But no one is going to ask you definition. I mean, derivations here. So I'm going to directly give you the equation Kp will be equal to Kc RT power delta N. This is the equation connecting Kp and Kc. Okay. And in this case, R value should be 0.0821. Okay, it should be 0.0821. And what do you mean by this delta N? Delta N is stoichiometric, total stoichiometric coefficient of react products minus that of reactants. Say for example, if I have a reaction like this, NH2 plus 3H2 gives 2 ammonia, right? If I take this reaction, I want to calculate delta N for this. It's pretty simple. Calculate what is the total number of stoichiometric coefficients in the product side. That is only one product is there. That is two, that has a stoichiometric coefficient of two, right? And there are two reactants here. One is having three, another is having one. Total is four. So it's not plus minus, right? So two minus four will become minus two. Right, it'll become minus two. That's how you calculate any reaction. Just take the stoichiometric coefficient of entire products and minus that with the entire stoichiometric coefficient of reactants. So whatever the value is, what is my delta N? Okay, temperature should be in Kelvin. Obviously, there is never an equation where you will substitute temperature in terms of degree Celsius. It is always Kelvin. Right? Okay. Fine. Moving on. What is the next thing here? We talked about KCKP. Actually, I don't do problems. Wait. So any problems, guys, when I go for problem solving, right, I would say the problems can be segregated into two types. Right. Now, what are the two segregations is when you have delta N is equal to zero kind of reactions. And obviously the reactions where delta N is not equal to zero. Right. So hope you understand what this delta N is, what I'm talking about. Right. Say examples of delta N is equal to zero reactions. If you want to have, say I have H2 plus I2 giving 2HI. Right. You see, stoichiometric coefficient here is 2. Here again, 1 plus 1 will become 2. Delta N is 0. Right. So these kind of reactions will have, it's not a different approach. I would say this kind of problems are a little more easier when compared to this kind of problems. I'll tell you why is it easier. Right. So guys, if you have any reaction like this, let me write the equilibrium constant for you. Right. Okay. KC, if you take, it will be say concentration of HI squared. Don't forget that. Divided by concentration of H2. Don't go the logical thing. This is a gas. How will you write concentration? Like this is just for an example. Don't worry about it. Okay. And I have I2's concentration. Correct. Right. So all you see is concentrations here. Right. So we know the formula for molarity. Molarity is nothing but number of moles by volume. Correct. So let me substitute the formula there. We'll see what happens. So it will be now. Okay, fine. I'll tell you that. So it will be number of moles of HI divided by volume the whole squared. Right. Now please understand, guys, this volume which I'm talking about, right, is the volume of the vessel. Right. So all these three things, that is H2, I2 and HI. One second, give me a moment. So yeah. So all these three things, that is H2, I2 and HI, will be in the same vessel. Isn't it? So this volume you are taking here, you will not have individual volumes for HI will have different, I2 will have different, H2 will have different. No, all of them will have same volume because all of them are in the same vessel, right? So this volume which I'm talking about is the volume of the vessel. Please be very careful. You don't have to worry much. So sir, they didn't give me volumes of all the species. They have given only the volume of the vessels. That's exactly what you have to use. Don't worry about it. Okay, fine. So divided by number of moles of H2. Oh, I don't have space. Wait, one second. Right. So number of moles of H2 divided by volume, right, into number of moles of I2 divided by volume. What happened? Okay. Okay, divide by volume. Now, what do you see here? One good thing will happen. What will you see is here? You have V squared here because you have a square. Again, in this multiplication also, you'll get V squared. So all the volume terms gets actually cancelled. Right? All the volume terms gets cancelled. So what you have is just the number of moles. Number of moles of HI squared divided by number of moles of H2 into number of moles of I2. Right? So that is the advantage of having this kind of reactions. That is, you really don't have to calculate the concentrations. You can directly find the equilibrium constant with respect to number of moles itself. Okay? With respect to number of moles itself, you'll be able to do the constant. You'll be able to find the equilibrium constant value. Right? But definitely, if you have delta N not equal to zero, there will be at least, say, this term will be remaining, or say one of the term will be remaining, the numerator, or say one of the term will be, denominator will be remaining, the volume term, telling, right? So you cannot directly use the number of moles. You have to find the individual concentrations for all the species, whatever is there in the reaction. Then you have to substitute in the KC equation. Okay, so that is why I told you that delta N is equal to zero kind of reactions are little easier to approach in the problem solving rather than having delta N not equal to zero. The only difference is delta N equal to zero, you can directly substitute the number of moles value. Delta N not equal to zero, you have to calculate the concentrations. Then you substitute it in the KC equation, or KP will be generally pressures. I'm talking about KC. Okay, right? Fine. So this I wanted to tell you, right? And I'll tell you the general approach of any problem solving, like any question given to you in equilibrium, how will you solve that question, right? So let me spend some time on that. Oh, okay. I can go up, I can go down. Oh, on note is amazing, right? Cool. So any problem, guys. So let me take a random reaction now. Not random, some reactions I'll take, right? And let me tell you what are all the questions which can be asked and how will you approach these questions. Right. Fine. So let me take up N2 plus H2O equation itself. But I have to use no issues. It is just for your understanding. So no problem at all. What is wrong? Okay, so let me take this reaction, right? So how will the questions be asked is generally, it can be like this. Say they give you, assume that they'll tell you that initially one mole of this and one mole of this are present. I'm just giving you a random question, guys. I have one mole of N2 and one mole of H2 present, right? Or they can give different also, one mole of N2, four moles of H2, anything can be given, doesn't matter, right? And say they will say that, they can give the equilibrium constant value also. Say KC is given to us. Say something like some value, I'm just taking a random value, say 2. That KC value is 2. Okay, and what will they ask is at equilibrium, what are the concentrations of all these species? That's what they'll ask. Okay, at equilibrium, what are all the concentrations of N2, H2 and NH3? That's what they will ask. And they are given the KC value, or it can be opposite. Right, I'll tell you what is the opposite. The opposite can be, they will give you the percentage completion of the reaction, right? And they'll ask you to find the KC value. So anyways, first we'll concentrate on this. Okay, say, now this is at time t is equal to zero, right? At time t is equal to zero, I have one mole of N2 and one mole of H2 and zero moles of ammonia, right? So guys, whatever you're doing here, that is at time t is equal to zero, you're putting the values, right? So this particular thing, what you're doing is what is called as equilibrium table. Okay. Now, if you do equilibrium table properly, 90% you will always end up in the right answer, right? But if you are going to mess up this part, I'm really sorry. Nobody can help you. Right. So making the equilibrium table perfect is one of the main things. If you do that properly, most of the work is done. Rest all will only be calculations. Okay. Fine. So at time t is equal to 0, I have 1, 1 and 0. Right? I'd say now I have to go for equilibrium. Right? When I go for equilibrium, I don't know how much N2 has reacted. I don't know how much H2 has reacted. And I don't know how much NH3 has formed. Right? So let me use some variables then. Right? Say, assume that some X moles of N2 has reacted. Okay? X moles of N2 has reacted. So what will be remaining is 1 minus X. Correct? Right? Now, if X... Now, see the stoichiometric coefficients. Here, I have the stoichiometric coefficient of 1. This is 3. That means what? For 1 mole of N2 to react, I require 3 moles of H2. Is it not? Right? So, tell me, what should I write here? Just like 1 minus X, which I wrote here. What should I write here? Any guesses?
One minus 3x.
Absolutely true. Right? So already one mole is there. They have given. One second, guys. Just give me a moment. Okay, so I don't know how many of you will have this problem generally, right? Early morning classes, if you wake up for that too on a Saturday, everybody will be sleeping. And I don't know whether you heard it. Someone was snoring in the background. So that's why I had to unmute. Anyways, so yeah, as you said, absolutely true. So I already have one mole, right? So you can see X moles of N2 is reacting. So definitely 3X moles of H2 would have reacted. Definitely, according to stoichiometry. So what will be remaining is 1 minus 3x is what is there. Right. Now, guess what will come here. I have unmuted, right? Okay. Fine. So, yeah, what will come here? Absolutely. There was nothing before. So I say 1 mole of N2 gives 2 moles of NH3. So I have X moles reacting. So I'll get 2X moles. That's it. Right? So this is what is the equilibrium table, people. Very simple. Okay? Right? So now these are the number of moles which we have taken. So obviously the volumes assume that the volume is a 5-liter container is what is given to you. Right? So now these are the equilibrium number of moles. Right? Now let me just stop this part. So these are the equilibrium number of moles. If I want the equilibrium concentrations, it will be 1 minus x divided by 5, 1 minus 3x divided by 5, and 2x divided by 5. These are the concentration values. Now, you know the Kc equation, the Kc value is given to you. I told that the value is 2. Now, substitute the values. How will you substitute? Right. So it will be 2x by 5. The whole squared, do not forget the equilibrium, the stoichiometric coefficients to the powers, divided by 1 minus x divided by 5. This is whole power 1. This is for N2. And another thing is left, that is 1 minus 3x. Divided by 5. You can see all the volumes I'm taking to be same. All over 5. Oh God. Okay. 1 minus 3x. The whole power 3. That's what should be there. Now you know the Kc equation. The value is 2. You have to find the x values somehow. And substitute it in this. Here. Right. Substitute in this equation. And these are all what my equilibrium concentrations. So now you have to substitute the x values and find the values. That's it. Find the overall value of the concentrations of N2, H2, and NH3. Okay. Right. Now, what is the other kind of problem they can ask is they will give you, say, they will give you any one of the concentrations. Say, assume that they have given the NH3's concentration. They'll tell like this, 1 mole each of N2 and H2 are present in a 5-liter container, right? At equilibrium, the number of moles of NH3 was, say, 0.3. Okay, the number of moles of NH3 at equilibrium is 0.3, something like that they tell, right? So what do you mean by that? 2x, which I've written here, that value is 0.3. Now, you know the x value, substitute the x values here, 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 and they'll ask you to find the Kc value. Pretty simple, isn't it? So either you can, but either way, you have to make the equilibrium table perfectly. If not, everything is collapsed. Okay, so hope everyone understood why did I put 3x here, why did I put x here, and this is where you start with, right? So x, something has reacted, right? So two kind of questions. One, they will give the Kc value, ask you to find the equilibrium concentration, or they can give any one of the reactant or products as concentration, right? And then they can ask you to find the Kc value, right? Okay, so this is with respect to Kc. Right. When it goes to Kp, guys, little it can get complicated. Let me tell you how. Right. So any questions, guys, with this? How to approach? Any questions? Okay. So if there are
why
any questions,
why did you divide it by yeah. 5, sir?
Good. Okay. So I told you that. Oh, sorry. Okay. So I told you the volume of the vessel is 5 liters. Right, I've mentioned it here, right? So what happened here, this whatever you wrote, 1 minus x, this 1 minus 3x, these are all number of moles, right? But for finding the Kc, what should I have? I should have concentration, right? So concentration is what? Molarity. Molarity is nothing but number of moles divided by volume. So these are the number of moles divided by volume, 5. 5 is the volume, 5 liters. That's why. Yes, understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Cool. Right. So now we'll just take some Kp, the same reaction, right? Same reaction. I can actually confuse you with Kp, right? So same thing. I'll take N2 plus three H2 gives two NH3, right? Now, same thing I'll give you. Initially, at time t is equal to 0, 1 mole of this and 1 mole of this and nothing was there. Okay, right? 1 more data I'll give you. Say the total pressure in the vessel, right? The total pressure, somewhere I'll write, total pressure of the vessel is assumed that it is 1 atm. Assume this is a closed container. Okay, so initially, whatever is the total pressure, that will be the total pressure even after the, oh wait, that cannot be the case. Okay. So this is total pressure at equilibrium. Assume that total pressure at equilibrium is 1 atm. Okay, right? Fine. So at time, these are the number of moles, guys. Please don't confuse. These whatever I've given you are the number of moles. Sometimes the problem will be very easy. They will directly give you in terms of pressure. Say if these are pressure values, pressure values, then you can directly put it in the Kp equation, right? But definitely they'll not give you like that, right? What will they give you is number of moles, right? And then they'll ask you to find the Kp, right? Something like that will you, that's what you have to do. Okay, fine. So now how will you go about it? Let me do the same thing. So at equilibrium, I know I have 1 minus x, 1 minus 3x, and 1 minus 3x, and here I'll get 2x. These are the equilibrium number of moles, right? Now, guys, if you want to substitute Kp, right, all you need is the partial pressures of all these three components, partial pressure of NH3 power 2, partial pressure of H2 power 3, I mean, divided by, and partial pressure of N2. All these things you need, but what you have is just number of moles, Okay, so how will you do? How will you go about it? Any idea, guys? How will you go about this? Number of moles, I somehow has to convert it to pressures. How will I do it?
Ideal gas equation.
Ideal gas, okay, fine. Makes sense, right? You have PV is equal to nRT. But what if you don't know the temperatures? You don't know what is the volume? You don't know all that. Then what will you do? Okay, I suppose you might not remember, but when I tell you, you will remember now. Okay, don't worry. So guys, let me come back to this KP later. Right. So hope you remember, there is an equation, Dalton's law of partial pressures. If you remember the equations, PA, that is, say I have two components, A and B are the two components in the mixture, gaseous mixture. Okay, so now how will I be able to write PA and PB? PA, I can write it as P total into the mole fraction of A. Same way, PB, I can write it as P total into XB, that is the mole fraction of B. Hope you remember this equation. It is similar to Raoult's law, which you studied. But again, there are differences. We'll go to solutions and we'll see what are differences, right? So PA, I can write it as P total into the mole fraction of A. Total pressure in the mixture into the mole fraction. Same way PB is equal to total pressure into the mole fraction of B, right? And that's exactly what we are going to use here. Do you remember these equations? Do you remember? You must have used this in the problem solving also in your solutions chapter. If not, I will definitely give you. Don't worry. Right? So you use this and Raoult's law in the same problems. There is, I think, one question in your NCERT book back also. I don't know how many of you would have solved. Right? So, yeah. So these two are the equations I'm going to use. Okay? We have a relationship between the partial pressures, total pressure, not exactly moles, but in terms of mole fraction. So obviously you have to convert all these number of moles into mole fractions. Then only you can continue. Right. Fine. So let me wrap this part. Hope you remember the equations. Right. Say now this is again the equilibrium in terms of number of moles. Okay, these are the number of moles. Now, if I want to write the same equilibrium in terms of mole fractions, X. Okay, if I write it in terms of mole fraction, you know how to calculate mole fraction. Number of moles of that particular component divided by total number of moles. Is it not? Say now for N2, it will be 1 minus X divided total number of moles. We'll calculate what is the total number of moles. It'll be 1 minus X. It'll be 1 plus 1. It'll become 2. How many x's? So you have minus x, minus 3x will become minus 4x, plus 2x will become minus 2x. Okay, so this is the mole fraction of N2 at equilibrium. Very important, right? Same way, if I want to write it for H2, it will be 1 minus x divided by same thing, total number of moles, that is 2 minus 2x. Oh God. Why is it happening? Do not. Okay, 2 minus 2x. Same way, this would be 2x. Divided by Okay, guys, I'll be happy at this with this. I don't know, some problem is there. Okay, so hope you understand. These are all the equilibrium mole fractions, right? Fine. Now we know how the mole fractions with us. We already know the total pressures with us, right? Total pressure I given you to be 1 atm. That's it. Now you can easily write the partial pressures. Right? You can easily write the partial pressure values now. What will be the partial pressure value? If at all, now in this case, it's going to be very easy, right? Because we know partial pressure of a component PA will be equal to total pressure into mole fraction of that particular component, right? Total pressure is 1. Right. So can I say the individual partial pressures will be exactly same? Okay. Or basically this thing says that whatever is above, the same thing will come here because the partial pressure is 1. If at all the partial pressure was 2, in total pressure was 2, then you have to multiply each of this with 2 and then you have to substitute the values, right? Now you know the individual partial pressures of all the components you need. Now finding Kp is going to be absolutely easy. Obviously, they have to give some amount of x, how you find out. It depends. Maybe they can give directly one value, right? And then you can find the X, or say they might give Kp value and then they ask you to find what is the individual partial pressures. That can also be asked. Okay. But if number of moles is given to you and if it's a Kp question, you have to convert the number. First, write the equilibrium table in terms of number of moles, convert them in terms of mole fraction and look for total pressure, what is given. And then use Dalton's law of partial pressures. Pa is equal to P total to Xa. And then you can do whatever you want. Okay, so what is more important is either it's Kp or Kc, doing the equilibrium table is the most important one. If you do that properly, as I told you, 90% of the problem is over. Okay, fine. So I think we have 15 more minutes, right? So there's only one topic less in equilibrium, that is now, then I can go for ionic equilibrium. Okay, so let me see. Oh, wait, I have actually one concept left. After that, I have one more concept. Okay, so... Guys, if there is a reaction like this, any questions, guys? Any questions from the previous case? Everybody understood what happened here? Right? I suppose everyone should have understood. If there's any doubt, you can please ask me. Right? Okay. Okay. Say, till now, whatever you have seen is that I have the reactants giving product if this is the equation. Right. So generally what will happen, I will have some amount of reactant and zero amount of products. I will not have any product initially. Okay. But what if you have both reactants as well as products in the mixture? Say basically in the previous example you take, if there was, assuming that there was one mole of this and one mole of this, and one mole of this, if I have. Right, if I had one mole of this, then how will you decide? See, this reaction can go in both directions, right? Right, if you had 1D reactants, you can definitely say for sure that yes, it is gonna move in the forward direction, right? But if at all you have both reactants as well as products initially itself at time t is equal to zero, right? At that time, how will you decide which side the reaction? Then only you can talk about all the other stuff. Is it not? Then only you can talk about whether it's going to be minus or plus, which is going to come here. All these things will be different. Isn't it? So now how are you going to predict whether the reaction is going to move forward or move backward? Right? In the initial condition, or say at some point of time, say at time is equal to 5 minutes, right? I had say the concentration of NH3 to be 1, right? Is there any chance in the middle of the reaction where the reaction can get reversed? Hope you understand the scenarios, right? The first scenario was initially some amount of reactant and the product were present, but you don't know which side the reaction will happen. Right? Or say other case can be initially it is going to move in forward direction, right? But after a point of time, it is going to move in backward direction. Something like that might happen. right? So how will you predict all this? It is easy. It is actually easy to predict. Okay, so for predicting this, we have one more factor which is going to help us, and that is what is called as your reaction that is what is called as reaction quotient. A reaction quotient is denoted by the letter capital Q. Okay, so again, you can have QC or QP depending on what reaction you have, but in general Q, right? So with the value of this and the equilibrium constant value, you like almost for all reactions that it is predetermined, the equilibrium constant values. Okay, so this, depending on this Q value and K value, I'll be able to predict whether the reaction is going to move forward or in the backward direction. Okay, now if you ask me, sir, what is the formula of this Q, it is going to be exactly same as the previous case. That is a product concentration, right? It is going to be product concentration divided by the reactant concentration only, right? But the only difference between this and this is that this concentration values you substitute here need not be equilibrium values. It can be initial values. It can be somewhere in between. It can be any, it can be equilibrium also, right? So this in K, I have the restriction. I have the restriction that the concentrations have to be substituted only when I have equilibrium, right? But this reaction quotient, right? I can have any values. So initially I had the problem, first case, right? So you will put the values of 1, 1, 1 in this, right? And compare it to the KC value. I'll tell you, right? So basically you can put any values here, any values in the sense at any point of time, whatever the concentrations are there, that concentrations you can put here. But for equilibrium constant, you have to use only equilibrium concentrations. Is it okay? Right, fine, cool. So now please understand, guys, Any reaction for that matter, the only motto of that reaction would be to reach equilibrium, isn't it? To reach completion. Not only them, like anybody, right? Anybody in this world wants to reach equilibrium, right? So the same goes with reaction also. Any reaction wants to reach equilibrium. That means how can I predict that the reaction has reached equilibrium? By looking at this value and this value, it's pretty simple. If you find that the Q value is equal to the K value, right? That means, what do you mean by that? That means the concentrations you have substituted here are actually equilibrium concentrations, right? So obviously I said that this has reached equilibrium, no doubt about it, right? Whenever you see that, the Q value is equal to the K value, no doubt that then the reaction has reached equilibrium. But if it is not equal, right, obviously then that means the reaction is still in the process of reaching the equilibrium, right? Now the question is, if Q is not equal to K, I told you that the reaction is in the process of reaching the equilibrium, but from which side, whether the forward side or from the backward side, it is going to reach equilibrium, that will predict now. Okay, fine. So moving on. Right. Say this is the first case. Let me put it like this. Say this in the second case, assume that I found out that Q value is less than the K value. Okay. Q value should be, I found out that the Q value is less than K. Say initially I found out initial concentration substituted. Right. So I find that the Q value is lesser than K value. Okay. So now what is it? It's basically going to be product concentration divided by reactant concentration. Okay, now as I told you, what is the time? As I told you, every reaction wants to reach equilibrium. That means every reaction, every Q wants to reach K. Indirectly, and I'm saying that every reaction wants to reach equilibrium. That means you want to have this as the final result. Q is equal to K. I want to do that. That it has to become that way. Okay, fine. So what I have to do, you see that here the Q value is lesser than K. Right. So what I have to do, can I say that I have to keep on increasing the value of Q so that at some point of time, it is going to become equal to K. Is it not? Again, I repeat, I have to keep on increasing the value of Q until it becomes equal to K. And I don't have to do it. The reaction only will do it. Right? Eventually, it will reach equilibrium. Right? Now, how can I increase the value of Q? Now, from the formula, I can see, can I say that I have to increase the numerator, decrease the denominator? Then only I'll have increase in value of Q. Right? So, how can I, now, what is there in the numerator? Numerator, I have products. Right? And denominator, I have the reactants. Right? So, what I'm trying to say, if you have this particular case, Q less than K, I have to keep on increasing the Q value. And what I mean by that is, I have to keep on increasing the product concentration and I have to keep on decreasing the reactant concentration. Now tell me which side the reaction will happen. I want to increase the product concentration. Absolutely true. So I want to increase the forward product concentration, decrease the reactant concentration. It is no doubt that you will find that the reaction is going to move forward. This is how you predict. Right? So this proves that. Oh my God. Fine. I will take some other space. Right? So this proves that the reaction is going to move in the forward direction. Okay. Right? Now, obviously, if you look at the second case, that is the third case, same definition, same explanations I can give you there. Sorry, this is third. Right? So Q greater than K. So obviously you're going to have backward reaction happening, but again, we'll see. So again, what you have to do is keep on decreasing the value of Q so that it will become equal to K and so that the reaction will reach equilibrium. So what you have to do in this case, you have to decrease the product concentration, increase the reactant concentration, and that will happen only if the reaction is going to move in the backward. Okay, right. So please be very careful, guys. If at all only reactant concentration is given, no problem, right? But if they have given reactant concentration as well as product concentration, for the initial concentrations, find the value of Q first, right? So then you compare the Q with K. Then you decide which side reaction is going to happen. Then you continue with the reaction. Then you continue with the calculations. Please be very careful. Again, I repeat. If only reactant concentrations are given, or if only product concentrations are given, you can easily predict which side the reaction is going to move, right? But if both of them are given initially itself, right, and the equilibrium constant value is given to you, for the initial concentration values, find your Q, compare it. If it's lesser, forward direction. If it's more, backward direction. This is how you predict. Okay. And there is one small part left, and that is your Lee-Chatelier's principle. Okay, so I think I'll take it up tomorrow. Okay, and tomorrow we'll be completing the first part of equilibrium. Lee-Chatelier's principle will complete and we'll do some problems and then done. The first part of equilibrium is over. Then we'll go for ionic equilibrium. Ionic equilibrium is only full formulas. I'll just give you the formulas, little explanation in somewhere, and then again problems. That's it. Okay, any questions, people, from all the things that you saw today? That's it for today. Done. Any questions?
No.
Okay. No, fine. I suppose there are no questions. Thank you, people. We'll meet again tomorrow.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.